Hey champs, welcome back to another episode of the Cheat Codes podcast. Here with the familiar, with Antonio, A Money back in the building. Really excited to have Bobby here with us. I've probably known of Bobby since you were like 11.
Yeah, 11, 12.
Yeah, that's crazy. So yeah, Bobby is super accomplished in his own right. He has a training contract at an elite law firm. He's a graduate of Durham University. He owns a bubble tea shop, which I think is ridiculously cool. Is there anything else I'm missing?
No, I mean, I think you covered all the key points, and you know, thank you for such a flattering introduction. I really appreciate that, man.
More than welcome. He's actually a man of many talents, so there'll be like other things coming out that he does that he's just tucked in his back pocket. But yeah. Hey, Money?
100%. Yeah, I mean, best place to start is from the beginning, right?
For sure.
So you said Tony's known you since 11, 12. What's your background, man? Like, where did you come from? Like, what got you to know each other in the first place?
Yeah, for sure. I'm happy. So, you know, first of all, my parents come from mainland China. So, you know, they were the first people to come over here. And I was born and raised in Chelmsford in Essex. And the way that I know Tony was actually quite an interesting story because, you know, I went to school with his younger brother and I was good friends with him from year 7 to year 9. And, when he went off to a different school, you know, I kind of had a few chats with him on Instagram and slowly ran into this figure called Crypt Tony. And, I saw his really inspirational stuff. So he was a couple years older than me, and I was seeing that, you know, especially for someone who wasn't really sure about what direction to take things in and was just really curious to learn about, you know, a lot of different things. I saw that Tony was definitely forging a pathway, and I was like, okay, I'm gonna get in touch with this guy. And I remember, Tony, man, I've been, you know, messaging you here and there about, you know, your thoughts on leadership, on ambition and things like that, and you've been incredibly helpful throughout. So yeah, thank you.
I'm super humbled, man, and it's always good to chop it up and do it on camera this time. It's actually like, I forget that it's been that long.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, I'd always hear great things from my brother and could always see that, like, he had the minerals and the discipline to actually actualize that. So I actually have no surprise that he is where he is at this point, like a decade on. I didn't like guess that you go into bubble tea, but I always knew you would do great things. So yeah, like, walk us through that. So you went to Kegs, which is like a super elite competitive school, probably top 10 grammar school in the country. What was school like for you?
For sure. So I really went into grammar school, as you say, and for me, I've always been quite academically inclined, right? So to enter into a grammar school, you've got to do the 11 plus exam. And, you know, from an early age, my parents were quite strict on me in terms of like making sure that I do my work before I go out to play, you know, read as much as I can and things like that. But, you know, it wasn't really until I'd say around year 11, year 12, when I started putting myself under pressure to perform academically. I've always been, you know, that kind of guy to, you know, mess around a little bit in class, you know, play a bit of a class clown, simply because, right, I didn't really know where I was going with my life. But I think it was around like year 11 where, you know, GCSEs were coming up, and I was like, okay, I don't actually know what I'm going to do, but I know what's coming up. So, you know, first thing for me to do was to attack what was in front of me. So, you know, went on, GCSEs went okay, achieved above average grades, but given, you know, my school and a lot of my peers, they were doing a lot better than I was. And then I realized that maybe I wasn't revising the correct manner. And I, you know, slowly started refining the way that I studied. And year 12, year 13 were game changers for me. I started reading a lot more in terms of helping myself understand the way that my mind works. And then thought about what career I really wanted to go into. And I was quite fortunate in that respect. I quite quickly settled on, you know, a career either in like in a corporate sphere, so either in investment banking or commercial law. But, you know, I really had really good influences at school. The teachers were amazing. And in particular, I had two really good English teachers. So Mrs. Riley and Dr. Colley, I'll name drop them. They really inspired me to really pursue that love of reading. So ultimately, after studying my A-levels, went on to university, and now graduated from Durham University in 2022 with a first class degree in English literature. So.
Flex. Today.
Amazing.
Also, like, what were your GCSEs? Because I know someone, like, him saying that he didn't, like, he got okay GCSEs at Kegs is, like, still a ton of A stars.
Yeah, A stars, four A's.
There we go.
average.
Nice. No, definitely. I think, like, it's really, I love, you know, this is not a study cheat codes plug, but, like, I love that process you talked about in terms of, like, self-discovery, in terms of learning how you work. What did that process kind of look like for you?
Yeah, I mean, for me, I really didn't know how to study. That was the thing back in year 10, year 11. I kind of was like, okay, just read the notes I made in school. And obviously, when you're not really paying that much attention in class, you're sitting at the back, you know, just throwing stuff, like not really focusing on what's going down, you don't have the best notes. So I think it was actually just really understanding that, okay, what is on the specification for the exam board, that's what's going to be assessed. And I think I'm going to talk to you about this, because I remember emailing you, I think, or either Instagram DMing you, and then you sent me what I believe is the prototype to study cheat codes.
The OG cheat codes, the raw version. Yeah.
And that was really, really helpful, because that helped me understand that, okay, it wasn't just me that was struggling with understanding how to navigate studying. This is, you know, a path trodden by many people. And so, you know, having, you know, Tony's, you know, guidance definitely helped. And then, you know, also myself in terms of experimenting and, you know, consuming content on YouTube, you know, reading about it. And, you know, initially I read a lot of like psychology books, you know, a lot of ways of helping myself focus. And I think after that, you know, after loads of trial and error, so my grades started creeping up a little bit. And, you know, when it was exam day in GCSEs, it was kind of like just game time, right? So just focus, get it through. And after that, A-levels, right, refined the process a lot more. And yeah, A-levels were done. And, you know, when it got to university, I was quite well-versed. It was more in terms of, how do I tackle the university curriculum and how do I perform to how they expect someone to perform at? So, and it's like kind of, how do you get that first class blueprint? But once you kind of get into that, you know, mindset and way of thinking, and you'll start to understand that, you know, they really value independent thought. So reading outside of the curriculum, especially for someone studying English Lit. So yeah, those are all kind of my steps in slowly getting to a place where I was quite academically confident. Yeah.
Bobby, you're a natural at this point.
Literally.
Yeah, shoot, man.
But yeah, one of the things that's come up quite a bit is consumption, right? So like reading, watching stuff, and, you know, having read your blog as well, and a cheeky plug for Bobby's blog, which is actually some really good stuff in there. I'm curious how that kind of shifted, not shifted, but like helped you form your mindset nowadays and the way you approach not just work and academic stuff, but life in general.
No, that's a really good question. And, you know, I'm going to go back to this quote and this concept that I stumbled across in my first year of university. And is this literary critic and academic called Hans Robert Yaus. And he coined this idea called the horizon of expectations. And, you know, it really, in simple terms, is talking about how everyone's understanding of the world is informed by everything that they've read and understood previously. And so taking that beyond just, you know, literature and, you know, English literature itself, but also about things that you consume on a day-to-day basis. So for me, it was really actually reading like philosophy that really got me into studying and really understanding, okay, this is how I can live my life and be a student of the game, right? Slowly studying about, you know, ways to enter different careers, different industries, but also understand how to navigate the world itself. And so, you know, I think I saw English literature as the perfect degree for myself, simply because I wanted to broaden that horizon of expectations. So, you know, not only studying English at uni, but I spent a lot of time reading history, reading philosophy, and my dissertation itself, right, was a conglomeration of everything that I've learned throughout uni. So yeah.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite words, conglomeration. Never thought we'd hear it on this poddy, but no, yeah. I actually think that's like deep, because I was actually going to ask, like, you, as you said, like, you're originally Chinese, English literature is just, you know, rare for male students to study generally. I don't know many Chinese students that study English literature, and also people as ambitious and like corporately minded as you. But I think like it's a really profound explanation of, you know, what drew you to English. Yeah. Have you seen, do you like, yeah, like what's your, do you have any like words of advice for people that want to study subjects that may not be seen as like traditionally employable? Because you've made a huge success of your English degree.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I mean, you know, just in terms of generally speaking, I think especially coming from a Chinese background, right, Asian background, you've got a lot of pressure to study something that is seen as naturally vocational. Mm-hmm. So say medicine, law or economics, something like that, which is seen as very employable. I think, you know, I did have a bit of a conversation when I was choosing my university degree with my parents, you know, should I study something like English? But, you know, first of all, I'd say, it's all to do with the skill set that you're building at university. And that comes from any degree, right? There's any sort of degree, any degree at a very good university or university itself, you can build a skill set which will allow you to be employable regardless of what industry you go into. So I'm talking about things like, from an English background, say attention to detail, interpretation, you know, focus, you know, being able to communicate effectively, both orally but also in writing, of course. But, you know, all of these skills, they're not confined to any particular sector. And, you know, whether you want to be an entrepreneur, a lawyer, a banker, or whatever you want to do in the future, these are skills that are incredibly valuable. So in terms of picking a degree, I wouldn't say there's any limitation. And in particular, right, so I'm currently just finished the conversion course for law. And in my cohort, I've had loads of incredible people, and they all come from different backgrounds. So I'm talking about, you know, their degrees, right? So I've got people studying biomedical sciences, and you know, they're ultimately pursuing a path in commercial law. So yeah, I mean, there's no real limit in terms of that, and I think it really depends on the person. It's more about who you become and whether you leverage that degree to become the best candidate, and I think that's really important.
100%. And I think that's Balls. So that's honestly for us as well, it's very applicable, right? Like my degree, as much as yours, probably to a higher degree, very much like made me a cultured person, right? Like it's the knowledge that you gain from it and your ability to interpret these events and see different points of view. Like I did history and international relations, right? So like place it into context, see biases for what they are, express your ideas properly. Like these are all skill sets, right? And things that I use in the day-to-day nowadays. Absolutely. In the same way that you do as well, right? And like how you drew philosophy into that and how you live your life and how you think about the way that things happen around you, I think is so important from a degree like that.
Yeah, fully. I think that's dope in the same way, like you being able to pinpoint a specific critic and quote it and have that singular quote. It's the same way, like similar to you, I studied politics with a mix of like sociology, international relations, even social anthropology. And going back to what you said, like at the start, when you don't really know where you're going, you kind of just come in and just be like, oh man, these guys are waffling. Like what's this thing in social anthropology? But when like you come into university from a standpoint of everybody that our lecturer puts in front of us, every idea that you encounter, like this person has spent their whole life in pursuit of knowledge, right? So even if I disagree with their standpoint, like there is something useful or there is a qualified perspective that's being presented to me, and I may disagree with it, but like there is something to engage with here. And yeah, like similar to you, there's specific like schools of sociological thought or political thought that have like become embedded in my worldview. It really wasn't until like my final year of university that like I came to every lecture early. I read, you know, I skimmed the lecture notes, and it only cost me like 3 minutes of my life to skim the lecture notes. And actually like engage with the ideas. And I know like how much richer I am, as you said, like culturally, intellectually, just as an individual for 1 year of like focused applied effort. And I do have like regrets of not having tried those other 2 years. All in all, like you're always like, you can't have any regrets, because if you made different choices, you'd be somewhere else, right? And if I hadn't, you know, taken those 2 years off studying to, you know, do things with the ACS, to play rugby, I wouldn't have had the same balance, right? But I think, as you said, like there is a wealth of like bringing together those ideas that you are encountering at university and just like assessing them at face value and seeing what resonates with you and what doesn't. And I think so many people don't like enjoy the richness of university for what it is, which is like an opportunity to encounter new ideas and like build a worldview, build a perspective, versus like, I think when you go into thinking about, I'm here to get a degree, a piece of paper and pass exams, like you cheat yourself of the opportunity to build, I don't know, a belief system.
Absolutely. And just adding on to that, you know, it just came to my mind that one of my favorite essayists, Thomas Carlyle, he goes on to say that, you know, every man is my superior in the sense that I can learn something from him. So I think with university itself, it's really important to utilize that network, right? You're meeting so many talented, smart individuals. You know, there's always something to learn, regardless of whether you agreed with their beliefs or not. There's something to gain from interacting with these people. And even beyond that, right? And going back to studying a, you know, humanities subject, you know, Thomas Carlyle also says that the greatest university of all is those written in words. And he's talking about books in that sense. And there's something to gain from continually studying and learning, even past, you know, what your professor tells you to do. And I think that's really important, especially as you leave education and go into the real world and go into the working world.
Oh, Philly, like even how we became business partners, like I got invited to a party from like a friend from school who like I'd done a favor when he was applying to London Business School. And he was like, bro, like I just want to repay you. Like you helped me. So like Tyler, who helps sometimes with our marketing, got a scholarship to London Business School. And he was like, T, like, you've got to meet my friend Antonio, et cetera, et cetera. So I pulled up to Antonio's for like a house party. And if anyone knows Antonio, like he has the perfect place for throwing those. And bro, we ended up just talking till 5 a.m. Like everybody had left. We didn't even realize people had left. And we were just talking about philosophy, like history, IR. And the reason is that like I can count on one hand in my 3 years from graduating university, like how many truly intellectually stimulating conversations I've had. Because I think like you get into the working world, like you're just trying to earn your keep, not end up homeless. Like life is like, life starts lifing. Like you figure out an adult when you get slapped with the first bill, you're like, wow, like this is real life. Mm. And so it's very easy to lose that love of like intellectual pursuit and engaging with new ideas and stretching your mind. And like, we get so surprised when there's like fake, like outrage online or like, you know, people have a lack of critical thinking, but you have to be really intentional about finding, you know, time to keep absorbing new information and then not just reading in isolation, because that's one thing, but then finding people to spar with and test your ideas with. And so like half the time when we, you know, come for like our company meetings, like after we're done with the main business, we'll usually end up discussing some kind of current affairs. And that's something I'm really grateful in the partnership. And I feel like we found another person to have those conversations with, because I think like it is something really important to keep growing, because we're only in our early 20s. There's so much, you know, by the end of the decade, and even, you know, when we eventually become, you know, have partners and become fathers, et cetera, like life keeps teaching you new lessons and you keep expanding your horizons. But it's very easy to like stop developing mentally at 21 if you're not intentional about doing that. So no, I think that was really, again, like I have nothing more to add to what you said, because I think it's super true.
Yeah, and I think you made two huge points there as well to touch on. Like firstly is this ability to learn from people that you meet, right? And I think that's something that most people go into an interaction happy to talk, right? And happy to share their story and go on about their life and their experiences and relate any story back to something they've lived. But if you approach an interaction with someone looking to learn, looking to listen to them and hear them out, you're always going to benefit from that. Because even if they say something egregious or plain stupid, you can then rationalize that and be like, okay, maybe this is why he thought that. Maybe that's why other people might think of it like this. So that's a super important point. And then the second one, which I thought was great, is just concept of self-education that Tony touched on as well. And it's just like in uni, most people go to uni, finish, and then never really like learn things moving forward. And if you can develop a habit of actually like cultivating ideas and testing things out and having conversations with people and reading new material and listening to different like intellectual viewpoints, that's really where you can take the step forward and stop, you know, prematurely developing up till 21.
Sure. Fascinating. I mean, on that point, I think we've gotten a picture of like clearly your elite academic caliber. So I don't think we necessarily need to dive deeper into that. And I think you've kind of summarized your study process and what contributed to your first class at Durham. But like, who are you at university outside of your studies? So really curious as to, you know, you're in great physical shape? What was like your athletic or sporting commitments like? What was your social life like? And what was just the general experience, you know, moving from, you know, we grew up in Essex, but it's not too far from London. So like you would have had a good understanding of what London life is like. What was like the transition to Durham like?
Sure. So for me, I chose Durham because it's quite a different environment from London. It's quite a quaint little city up north. And I really wanted to experience this really academic surrounding, right? So for me, I went into university really trying to leverage that opportunity and learn as much as I can throughout that. So, you know, additionally, I have quite a, I'd say, a little bit unique of a university experience simply because of the coronavirus pandemic. But, you know, during university, you know, in my final year, I was the president of the Durham Commercial Affairs Society and the vice president of the Non-Law into Law Society. And I was also the campus ambassador for Zero Gravity, a social mobility organization targeted towards helping students from lower socioeconomic backgrounds access higher education, in particular, enter into Russell Group universities. So, you know, I spent a lot of time, you know, trying to take advantage of the platform, trying to, you know, both consume and learn as much as I can, but also pay it forward and also help other students, you know, learn and also help introduce them to different industries and things like that. And that was the key focus of mine when I was the president of the Commercial Affairs Society, is really to help students understand what the possibilities were. And, you know, and as I started learning more about it, I realized that, you know, at such a young age, you know, opportunities are endless. There's no limit to it. So, you know, as long as you're, you know, trying to learn and really take advantage of opportunities as they come, you know, there's, the world is your oyster. There's so much to do. Yeah.
Yeah. And during your time also, you know, we've brought up the bubble tea store, but just kind of curious about the build up to that, because before off camera you were saying in first year you tried like an entrepreneurial venture and it didn't really work, and then third year you went on to open the bubble tea store that's still operational today. So yeah, curious about kind of like the progression throughout.
For sure. So, you know, I've always had quite an entrepreneurial mind in the sense that I've always wanted to understand how businesses work. I was growing up, I was just fascinated by these large conglomerates and seeing, you know, how did they function, right? How are they, you know, multinational and still able to operate at that level? And so for me, going into university, I was like, oh, I'm so hungry. I want to, you know, do everything. And, you know, I started a meal prep business for student athletes in my first year. And, you know, I co-founded that with a friend from my college at university as well. And that was the first real taste of entrepreneurship for myself, and that I learned so much from that experience. So for example, you know, marketing, understanding the market, research, both primary and secondary, and also in particular, I think positioning and supply chains. All of these things are the fundamentals of, you know, starting a business. And I think a lot of that came from experience, because going into it, you're kind of, you know, you've done your research, but you don't understand the practicalities of running it. And often you make so many mistakes in the first run. And so, you know, that business ultimately didn't do as well as I expected it to do. And I think half of that was, you know, our inexperience alongside, you know, the market at the time because of COVID. And so, you know, and starting my bubble tea business, that was in my final year. So I was quite fortunate, adding a bit of background to that, I was quite fortunate to secure my training contract at the commercial law firm towards the end of my second year. So going into my final year of university, I had a bit more free time, well, focusing on academia, but outside of that, I had a bit more time to explore different opportunities. And so, you know, with that in mind, I've always wanted to spot some sort of gap in the market. I was just really just having a look around, right? I wasn't really looking to start a business right away. But then, you know, for me, and one thing that you said as well, like I really enjoy going to the gym, keeping fit. And, but, you know, for me, I've always loved drinking bubble tea, right? I've drank ungodly amounts of it at university. I was like, you know, having a couple a day. But I've always wondered, you know, is this really the healthiest thing that is going into my body? And you see all these big change dominating the market. And I was like, okay, I'm not sure whether, you know, this is going to be sustainable for myself in terms of keeping my health levels up. But then also, I've also been really interested in tea making, the culture in China, you know, loose leaves, organic brewing, all of that stuff. Seen that growing up, you know, my parents drank so many different types of tea, you know, jasmine, oolong. And for me, I was like, okay, I really like culture and I really like, you know, bubble tea itself. Is there any way for me to bring it all together, you know, bring all my interests together to form a product that is not just traditional and authentic, but also modern in the sense that it's a bubble tea, it's a trendy product, but also healthy. And, you know, after loads of brainstorming, you know, discussions with friends and, you know, all of that, you know, experimentation and research, you know, on a random, you know, October evening at the Bill Bryson Library in Durham, tea culture itself, it sprang to my mind, wrote down a blueprint and thought, let's go for it. Yeah.
It's dope. I mean, so at that point, you said, okay, in the words of Richard Branson, screw it, let's do it. What's the next phase, right? Because so many people have ideas. You know, I have an ongoing list of business ideas that I just keep tracking, right? So, you know, writing the business plan is one thing, getting the vision. Where did you move from strategy to execution, right? So you have your plan that you did in the library. What was the next steps from there to make it a reality?
I think, you know, half of that also comes down to the market condition, right? You've done the research. You have a good idea of what it's going to be like. But then, you know, are you able to bring that into fruition and actually start it? I think half of that is actually the market and luck as well. So I was quite fortunate because bubble tea is quite a low barrier to entry market in the sense that you don't need a tremendous amount of seed funding to start something like that, because what you do need to is the supplies, the machines, and you know, that overall, you know, in terms of shipping it over from another country, it won't amount to, you know, something as extraordinary as, you know, starting some sort of app or anything like that. So it's a bit different. But then also for me, I wanted a brick and mortar store, right? I wanted to have a shop where I could bring products that I came up with and things that I really enjoyed making and share it with the population. So, you know, my next step was to see if there was any place willing to take me. And, you know, here is when luck comes in, right? Because when I was doing all this research, a lot of people were leaving the high street because of the coronavirus pandemic, that a lot of people weren't willing to stay on it because of the rent and all the high costs associated with that. And therefore, the high street was quite empty. And I was able to negotiate quite a favorable, you know, lease for myself, you know, as a result of that market condition. And, you know, after, you know, having a bit of a discussion with the landlord, I was able to secure a place where it was previously an office and then really see whether I can transform that into a place which could produce drinks. And I think that was very tedious, right? It was quite difficult because I was operating from Durham up north and I was communicating with people from my hometown in Chelmsford. But, you know, ultimately was able to get that through. And then by that point, I was thinking, okay, this is really going to happen now. I'm going to have to give this a shot. And so, yeah, that's how it all came together. And I was like, okay, here we go.
So, I mean, do you want to shoot?
No, I just think it's crazy how the same thing that stopped you from starting the food prep business properly and got that off the ground was what opened up the condition for you to then go on to start the bubble tea shop, right? It just goes to show, like, you, some people view something as an obstacle, others will view it as an opportunity.
Yeah, the irony is, like, Joe was so funny. So his housemate literally said the last time I was in the house, he was like, oh yeah, we were talking about something, and he was like talking about the Chinese word for opportunity being the same as the word for crisis, which is like well-known cliche, which I don't know if that's the actual case in the original language, but it's true. It's like you can look at a situation and see a crisis or see an opportunity to flip it into something else. I think what was also really interesting was that two things is A, like, you've always operated in markets that you had a degree of passion in. So it was either taking the love of, you know, physical wellness, as an athlete, as a gym attender, to then provide a service in terms of meal prep. And then, you know, initially I was thinking, you know, bubble tea, where's the connection? How did you end up in it? But actually hearing the brand ethos, the story, it's actually a manifestation of the same instinct or the same mission applied to another vehicle, which is you were conscious about your health, you loved bubble tea, you wanted to bring your culture into it, and you made a healthy drink that also capitalized on a trend that's existing. So whether you know or not, you actually have a very consistent mission, which is to kind of fuel high performing people and people who are health conscious in novel, exciting and like tasty ways. And so it's really interesting, not just like how market conditions manifested in two different businesses favorably and unfavorably, but also shows you that you have a very consistent mission outside of your aspirations to be a corporate lawyer, which I think is fascinating. I don't know if you have a vision, a mission statement for your bubble tea, but there's one driving it, whether you know it or not.
Yeah, no, funny you should ask that. You know, I remember actually, you know, trying to sum in it down into three key tenets of the business and really talking to my employees about it and trying to get them to really spread that. So I'd say the three key words here are first tradition, so authenticity, the culture, you know, the love of making tea. Secondly, fresh ingredients. And I think this is really important because a lot of bubble tea shops, because they want really exotic colors, exotic flavors, they, you know, often use powdered and artificial products to kind of create that. One thing that I decided not to compromise on was quality and making sure that I had the freshest ingredients. We actually make, you know, fruit drinks with fresh fruit, so no artificial colors, powders or anything like that. So that was really key for me. I really wanted to drill into that. And then finally, that was just health centric. I wanted something that people could consume and still feel good about it, right? It's not really like a cheat meal. It's something that contributes to your health. And therefore I've also installed, you know, various sugar and ice levels. You can all customize it, allow consumers to, you know, make the drink what they want it to be. And so I think those are the three key ways that I've really, you know, visualize my business going. And I don't plan on like deviating from these three kind of tenets of the business anytime soon.
I'm inspired as hell. I don't know, it's kind of crazy.
And on that point of passion, man, you know, I know that you're very well read. You have your, you know, perspectives and things in order in your head. What role would you say that passion really played into it, right? Because there's that school of thought of like, oh, don't follow your passion, do what's practical. And there's the school of thought of like, follow your passion and live life on your own terms. Where would you say you stand on that?
I think I'm someone who lays ground quite outrageous goals. And the way that when you asked that question, my thought was, why can't you do both, right? Why can't you, you know, follow your passion, but also make it practical? Because, you know, I thought for me, I didn't really consider anything in terms of like it being my passion. It's just something that I wanted to do. And I saw an opportunity in the market to do that. I thought that it was going to be quite a disruptive product, something that was quite new and innovative. And I think, you know, as I say that, you know, as I said before, it's quite a low barrier to entry market, so you're going to face competition anyway. So I was thinking, you know, how do I differentiate my product? And so, you know, when I think about that, I say that passion is always going to be there in terms of like a driving force. Oh, you feel the need and you want to execute something, you want to do it. But then at the same time, you also can read the surroundings, read the environment, and, you know, ultimately spot something that you can do that both encapsulates your passion, but also is practical as well in that moment in time.
Yeah, fully. And I think like you, like to execute or to be practical at an optimal level, passion is almost required, right?
Absolutely.
In the sense of you do things better when you love it. Mm-hmm. And you're always operating from passion, right? Like, yeah. People that are mercenary are operating out of a passion for money, right? There's always something driving or motivating you. So if you pick something practical, you're still being driven by a passion. It's just a passion for money or success, in and of whether or not you're interested in the industry that you work with. And you always run the risk of hitting a ceiling of success where you've now made more money than you ever dreamed of, and that ceases to motivate you. Versus, and there's nothing wrong with doing that. I think, you know, if in the absence of an opportunity to do what you love, and depending on the circumstances of where you are, right? Like sometimes your family just needs bread, and if you want to put food on the table, you find the most efficient vehicle to do that. And there's also, you know, certain industries that it's hard to do, right? Right. They aren't necessarily scalable, right? So for example, with your like bubble tea, what's really interesting is like, you can franchise that quickly. You can scale to other locations. There are vehicles to make that a scalable, go from a six figure to a seven figure to an eight figure business. Like it can be done. versus, I don't know, if your chain is, if your passion is, you know, yoga studios or yoga, like you can, there's things you could do, right? You could create a yoga app. You could create a chain of yoga stores, but it's just, it's not a product, it's a service. So the scalability is harder. Don't get me wrong, there are ways that, you know, we could do a brainstorm and find a way to build a highly profitable yoga business.
And people have,
right? It might be apparel, you might make yoga pants as opposed to whatever, right? But I think, you know, it could be a whole nother fun podcast segment where we just come up with business ideas and brainstorm how we'd make it reality. But I think, like, fully to what Bobby was saying is, why have it be either or? And I think that's something that, like, our parents' generation and older people often, like, make it feel like your dreams are unrealistic, or they have to come at the expense, or, you know, grind now, shine later. And it's like, I'm always super interested in, are there ways to do both? Are there ways to make the necessary sacrifices to, like, build a business, but also, like, enjoy myself at the same time? But I'm really curious about something you said, because it relates to something that I had at a similar age to you, and I maybe didn't handle it as well. But I'm really interested in how you did. You mentioned your employees. So how old were you when you started the business? 20?
20, 21.
Yeah, yeah, cool. So I'm really curious, how many employees do you have? And, you know, you're currently in law school. You were in Durham when you started the business. You were doing your finals. How did you, you know, first of all, how many employees do you have? What was the recruitment process? And how do you continue to manage that business? A, there's a ton of questions here. How do you manage that business? A, with, like, your commitments to studying. And B, how do you just manage the psychology of being an employer of labor so young?
That is a very great question, but also a very difficult question to really pinpoint down. I think, you know, it's really interesting because, you know, at such a young age, you're now, you know, helping people, you know, you're paying people, you're helping people with their jobs. But, you know, I think for me, the way that I managed the business, especially at a really, you know, in the early stages, I was trying to put on as much of the workload on myself as I could. I needed to get everything down to try and understand whether this was feasible. And now, you know, the team has grown to about 9 people, and I'm hoping to expand it to 12 in the summer, where it's peak months, where, you know, there's as much demand as there can be. So now the team is slowly growing. But, you know, the foundation of it remains the same. I'm still trying to be on site as much as I can. But as you can see, I'm here today, which means that, you know, the team is able to operate without me. But that still means that I have a manager, and also my parents have been incredibly supportive with that as well. I think, you know, it's a really big luxury to have your parents, you know, support your vision. And so when I'm not there, my parents go in, my mom goes in, has a look at the employees, has a look at the business itself, see if there's any issues that needs addressing. But, you know, in terms of the key strategy itself, I'm still trying to iron that out and see how the business can grow. And in terms of how did I, you know, start hiring people, you know, I did a lot of research, but I ultimately decided that I think Indeed was the way to go, right? It's like the easiest way to get, you know, your stuff out there and have people apply. And, you know, there obviously was the interview process, because I wanted people who actually shared some sort of passion for entrepreneurship, because I wanted someone who wanted to learn as much as I did. And so a lot of my employees are students. They're from the ages from about 16 to 20. And they are, you know, all incredibly helpful in every part of the business. A lot of them know how to make drinks now. A lot of them, you know, are very proficient at handling the counter, speaking to customers. And I think I've always emphasized to them that part of this, as much as it is a learning process for me, it's also something that they can gain as well in terms of the skill set. You know, there's this one particular girl who was really, really shy at the beginning, but, you know, we've spoken about speaking to customers, introducing different products, making recommendations, and now, you know, she's, you know, one of the people who is always there, always really talkative to customers. And that's something that I'm particularly proud of, is that kind of development arc that I think you're not only making, you know, yourself, but also you're helping make other people. Is this idea of, you know, paying it forward that I particularly abide by, that really think is a central part of my life philosophy. And I want to support as many people as I can with their own mission as I, you know, go forward for mine. So that's the way that I see employing people. But yeah.
Yeah, again, I have nothing to say, but I think let's not gloss over that. As you said, you have 9 employees in your business at the age of 22, and you know you're about to scale to 12 employees. I think that's it's a huge feat to have. Was it a similar employee count when I was your age? And I know how difficult it is, especially to manage the psychology of it. Yeah. I think, like as you said, like maybe it's a bit easier because your employees are students, but that doesn't take away from the fact that they rely on you to potentially pay bills. They may be supporting themselves already or contributing to their parents or need it to get back and forth from college. You know, how do you think about leadership and the responsibility of being a leader, and what resources have been helpful in kind of you learning to lead the team and helping them develop, as you've mentioned?
You know, I think one thing that I really struggled with, especially at the start, was I always thought that if I wanted to get something done perfectly, that I had to be the one doing it. And I think, you know, it's really hard because you want to get someone also invested in their vision so they can execute something that you want to do. But it's part of that delegation, right? And, you know, I've mentioned this previously, but one thing that really helped me develop that skill of, you know, knowing when to let someone just do it so that they can learn and we can develop it together was actually, you know, during my presidency of the Commercial Affairs Society. You know, I had this vision of broadening everyone's horizons in terms of understanding what industries they can go into, and so I wanted to let people have their own project to run in terms of bringing a guest speaker in and, you know, having them do all of that. But one thing that I struggled with was sometimes I thought that other people didn't consider as many, you know, theoretical outcomes as I did, because sometimes I feel like, you know, they haven't looked at this carefully enough or anything like that. But, you know, I think you've got to leave some room for error. And also, you know, in terms of your own perspective, you've got to humble yourself a little bit, because your way is not necessarily the correct way. And I think whenever I think about things that, you know, there are competing opinions and, you know, differences of mind in terms of how to execute something, I always go back to this idea from Friedrich Nietzsche. And he says, you know, you have your way and I have my way. In terms of the right way, the correct way, and the only way, there is none. So, you know, you just need to help other people see the vision and then hopefully get them invested into going through with that. And as a result, you know, you can help learn together and try to devise an efficient method of getting to where you want to go. Mm. And yeah, that's all I can say for that, really.
Huge. Yeah. And I think a testament to that is also like the type of people that you're able to hire and attract and bring around you. Because some people just aren't up for putting in the extra work, aren't up for going the whole way through or giving their 100% or really like actualizing something that they set their mind to, whereas other people will go above and beyond, mm-hmm. right? So it's being able to position yourself where you're someone that people who want to be above and beyond want to work for and with. And that's the saying, right? Like A players want to work with A players.
Absolutely. Exactly. Yeah, literally that. It's like, we always joke here, like, The phrase I always use is like trying to build the 1996 Chicago Bulls. And you can't have championship players if you're not Michael Jordan or if you're not Scottie Pippen. Like, the leadership by example, and you clearly give 100% to everything that you do, whether it be your business, whether it be, you know, law. I'm interested in terms of it, because this is something that we were talking about on the way here. And I think maybe we could learn a ton in terms of some of the things that we're trying to figure out. But this is like, as you mentioned, you had your parents who are on site, you're on site as much as you can be. Are there any particular like tools, systems that you leverage? Do you like have integrations from a software perspective or automation that kind of helps you run the business efficiently? And then I have a follow-on question to that. Actually, let me flip it, rewind. How many hours, so currently you've just finished your GDL. You're taking some time to focus on the business, and then you'll go and do your LPC and then start a training contract at a law firm. How many hours does it currently take you to study? And what is like your day-to-day setup as a law student?
Yeah, that really varies, actually. So, you know, with my GDL, well, now it's called the Law Foundations course. You know, it really depends because, you know, we only go in, I think, 3 or 4 days a week, right? So we're not constantly at law school. But the most difficult thing about it was the sheer amount of content that you needed to cover. So for me, I found it really difficult at first to juggle everything I wanted to do. So, you know, in terms of how many hours I was putting in, I was really putting in overtime because, you know, my shop opens at 12 and it closes at 8 p.m. So there's this 8-hour window where, you know, I had to be on call and might not necessarily be constantly on site, but I had to take, you know, calls in terms of if any issues pop up. In terms of allowing, you know, people to integrate well with the team, I always have an onboarding session with them. I will be with them for the first 2 weeks as much as I can. I've got this kind of introductory shift period where I help to, you know, help them adjust to the system. But also one thing that I do assess is how well they bond with the other members of the team. Because at the end of the day, everyone needs to be able to trust each other. Everyone needs to have their own system of working that is efficient. So, you know, that's one thing that I really try to emphasize. This is a family here. This is, you know, not just, you know, you're just not here just to be a cog in the wheel. You're part of the mission itself. Then, you know, I try to study before the shop opens as much as I can. So sometimes that means waking up at 5 a.m., 6 a.m. And then, you know, after the shop closes, I do all the accounting, looking at all the figures and getting that, especially at the end of the week. And then trying to squeeze a couple hours before bed. But, you know, as exams neared, that meant that I only spent, you know, 1 or 2 hours focusing on business. And that was mostly at the end to look at the day, how the day went. Because at that point, I wanted to have my team all trained up, which was quite lucky and everyone was able to do that. And then, you know, I spent a lot more time focusing on my exams because, you know, can't fumble that. So, yeah. But Tony, I wanted to actually throw this question back at you as well to some extent, especially about what you were speaking about earlier in terms of managing employees. You know, what would you say is your biggest lesson that you took away from your time you know, running your business?
It's a great question. Yeah. That's a great question. I think there's two things. And I've had a year and a half now to like really digest the lessons. I think it's two things. I'll say one first, just because it echoes what you said. I think it's humility as a leader. I think it's realizing that you don't know everything. I think I'm a very confident, self-assured person with a lot of conviction. But actually, funny enough, I don't think the problem at the time was me thinking I know everything. I think the problem was me thinking that I have to know everything. And those are two different things. I think the ability to the ability to show vulnerability and weakness is really key as a leader. At the end of the day, right? Like nobody wants to follow somebody who doesn't know where they're going. So the vision has to be clear. Your ability to lead has to be clear. But there are going to be situations where you genuinely don't have all the answers. And that's exactly why you have a team, right? And so the ability to say to somebody, hey, Antonio, and I think it's something I'm getting better at, is like, hey, there's this situation. I've thought about XYZ solution. I don't actually know the routes forward. What do you think? It's something that I really struggled with at first. There were tons of things. We had investors, we'd raised venture capital, which I think also added pressure. And so at 21, you know, being a venture-backed CEO, in a highly regulated industry, hiring people for the first time, you know, having 10 plus employees at a point in time, almost 15 maybe, if I remember correctly. Yeah, there was a pressure on me to feel like I knew how to do everything. And I should have actually just said, yo, like, this is my first time. I don't have all the answers. I may have good instincts. I need help. And so, yeah, I think that leaning on mentors more, leaning on my leadership team more, my business partners, and feeling like it was okay to sometimes not know what was going on, I think is the first thing. So the first thing is being willing to be vulnerable. Second thing I think is like, you know, it's the law of the lid in John Maxwell. So John Maxwell has the 21 irrefutable laws of leadership, which if anybody takes on a leadership role for the first time, whether it be a student society, that was the very first book my dad gifted me when I became president of the ACS. And I think like that's the leadership blueprint for anybody. The second law is the law of the lid, which just means like everything. So the first law, sorry, is everything rises and falls on leadership. So in a nation, in a family, in a community, if something goes wrong, ultimately it's the leader's responsibility. The second law is the law of the lid, which is a company, a family, an organization, a nation can't rise beyond the capacity of the leader. So everything that goes on in a business is ultimately an indication of the current level of leadership. So if you want to expand the business further, you have to expand the leader. So if I wasn't mentally on form, I become the bear in the business. If I'm not continuously growing and expanding, I'm the bear in the business. If there's a personal issue going on, I'm the bear in the business. And so I think that second thing is realizing that like empathy, family, community is really important, but also the most selfish and selfless thing is to make sure that I'm good as the leader, because the more I'm sleeping better, the more my health is in check, the more clarity of mind I have, the more emotionally balanced I am, the more time I've invested in personal growth so that I can see further, the more I'm building new relationships, the more the business grows. Because again, the law of the lid, imagine yourself as a container. If we're in a shoebox, the business can't grow beyond me as the shoebox. If we room to move to this, if my capacity moves to the size of this room, all of us grow. And I think that's the second thing, is realizing that you can spend so much time like trying to make sure everybody's okay. And if you as the leader aren't making sure that you have capacity so that you have things to give to your people, you have nothing left. So I think those are the two things I learned, is A, I don't need to know everything. That's what the team is for. And B, I need to continually invest in my growth and my well-being, because that sets the example and capacity for the rest of the team to grow. So I think that was a long-winded breakdown, but I think those are the two things that I learned in like that 2-year period for sure.
Yeah, thank you. That's incredibly profound actually, yeah. And being able to digest that into two kind of somewhat concise ideas.
Somewhat concise.
Yeah, no. Somewhat concise, because you know, you spent a lot of, you know, way of speaking about it, but you've really been able to drill down onto those key things. And I think that's incredibly helpful and definitely something I'll be bearing in mind in the future.
Antonio, do you have anything to add in? A question for you.
Like, how much do you think you've taken that on nowadays? Because like, I have my perspective and I do think you have.
Give me an answer.
No, because yeah. I definitely, like, for example, the vulnerability side, 100%. I think you don't have, like, even from when I met you, I think there's been an evolution in that sense of like, you're willing to be open. You're willing to ask for advice. You're always asking how I am, how I'm doing, how things are going on my side, if there's anything you can help with, if you need anything from me specifically. Like, I think you've been a lot more able to show that. I mean, I have no reference point, but even from when I met you, as I said.
No, I appreciate it. I think for me, it's how much have I taken that on board? I think it's more the second point now, which is, now we're at a point moving from basically two of us, we have a team, but our team are all part-time, they help where they can, to saying, okay, let's professionalize, let's look at bringing in, you know, a team full-time, let's look at potentially running a proper internship program. It's very similar to like what Bobby was saying, is, you know, there's a Bernard Arnault quote that I love, and he's the founder of, well, not the founder, he's the owner of LVMH. The founder of it in its current iteration, and there's a quote that he has which I love, which is like, success for me is leading the team and leading the team to the top. And it's and he also has another quote which is about, you know, essentially like, don't worry about profits, like worry about doing a good job and the profits follow. And I think it's like, you know, talking to my aunt, who's an incredibly successful CEO of a fintech startup. She's in her mid-30s. They just raised a round of funding, a $300 million valuation. And I pinged her a little WhatsApp last week to be like, you're killing it, like inspiring me in terms of where I want to be in a decade. And it was funny, we were having this conversation about a year ago, and she was like, look, T, like, it's not just about like the money you make. It's when you're a leader, when you're a founder, it's actually the people you build. And that's another really key thing that I've learned from my dad, that I've learned from the John Maxwell books, is like, at the end of the day, like, we build people and the people build the company, right? So it's exactly what you were saying about that development arc. It's about building a family, making sure the culture is right, making sure that everybody in the team is on one page, believing in the vision, the mission, and the beauty that you get to see of like that journey of development. And I was saying to Antonio off camera, you know, the one thing that has really eased my, you know, feelings about that period of my life is like, I got to grab lunch a couple of weeks ago with one of our interns, and you know, he runs an incredible, he's your age, should actually introduce you guys, but he runs an amazing six-figure software development agency, and working for us was like his first gig, his first internship, and he got the opportunity to be like a product manager in a venture-backed startup and leverage that credibility to start doing it as an agency for other businesses. And you know, he's come back and we have a call at the end of the week to talk about me helping him with business development for his agency and scaling it. And to realize that, you know, over a 2-year period, how much someone has developed from the 3 months that they spent with us, and the fact that he's now an employer of labor and he's now growing the business. That's something I take pride in. And I think having the opportunity to do that again with you now and just making sure that like we're better this time, and each time at each hire we make, we get better. I think that's really my biggest reflection now, is just continually refining myself so that we can build really cool people. Because I think with Cheat Codes, with Culture Capital, with like the vision is really to like, the way there's a PayPal mafia, you know, is wanting to look down the line 30, 40, 50 years from now and be like, not only have we hopefully hit 9 or 10 figures individually, but like look at a ton of other like, well, formerly young people, because we'll probably be like 70 or 80 at that point. But look at like the amount of people who went on to build incredible companies or incredible nonprofits, and be able to collectively look at like the impact of the network and be like, oh shoot, like we've impacted hundreds of millions of people, not necessarily through us, but that person that was an intern for 6 months went on to start that thing and they employed 2,000 people. And that person who worked with us for 2 years in marketing went on to start that company that has impacted 1 million people. So if we aggregate the network of all the people in Cheat Codes, whatever it's called when we're 80, the retirement club or whatever, yeah. I think like that's what success really looks like. It's not really like the amount of money you make, although that's important. I think it's really, as you said, that ability to develop, both grow as individuals and then grow as a team and see where people go and where they go with it. I think that's probably the biggest takeaway and the thing that I'm most excited about as well moving forward.
100%. Yeah, the Chico's Mafia.
Yeah.
Literally coming up. I mean, on that point, it's something we did want to speak about. Sure. You know, because Bobby was one of the OG applicants and members of Cheat Codes community when we first launched it out December last year, and I'm curious about your thought process going into it. You know, you see it, I'm assuming, through Tony's stories, and it's a concept and you're straight in through the door. So absolutely. Yeah, what was that like from your point of view?
For sure. You know, for me, one thing that I found incredibly exciting about the Cheat Codes community when it first launched, when I saw it on Tony's story, was that this was a community for young people to really both grow themselves, but also help other people. And I think that's one thing that I think is potentially lacking in the market, is simply because, you know, when we're trying to study, you know, people's lives and how to navigate the working life, you've got loads of autobiographies. You've got so many, you know, biographies, autobiography stories about how people navigated, you know, life itself. However, I think at such a formative age, or at, you know, at 18 to about 25, 30, you know, you're starting that first few steps, but we don't really get that much insight into how someone played the game at university, how someone navigated the first, you know, getting that first job, how someone navigated the first few steps of the corporate sphere. And so what I really wanted to see and continually to learn was people, you know, who are a few years above me, not, you know, decades or like, you know, 50 years older than me, but also people who are just, you know, also having that first foray into business, into their sphere, and learn from that, but then also provide the experience that I have garnered over the few years that I've been, you know, trying my best to learn, and provide that to the upcoming generation, those people who are, you know, currently in secondary school, who are, you know, going into their first year of university. And, you know, if we can provide value to them in any sort of way, I think that's a job well done. So when I saw the Cheat Codes community become alive, I was, you know, right there. I wanted to be, you know, part of that first intake and, you know, see how the business grows and, you know, be a part of that journey.
100%, man. I think there's something you brought up that I wanted to ask earlier as well. It's this like willingness you have to give back and to teach other people and to spread your lessons, which I think is very noble. But also, if you look at it like from your own point of view, there is that thing that like, okay, if you teach other people, it like reinforces lessons and you're learning yourself. But I'm really curious, like where that stems from you, like where does your willingness to teach others to spread your message really like stem from and result in the blog and, you know, what you wanted to say, about cheat codes and the way that you come in as well. Yeah, really curious, like the place that's from.
For sure. And I think that really comes down from, you know, the willingness of other people to help me. Right. I've had so many incredible mentors in my life so far, especially going into university, speaking to alumni, also going to these law firm events in my first year, second year, these open days, these insight schemes, and speaking to so many people who are willing to share their journey. And, you know, one thing that I kept on doing was keep in touch with these people who helped me along the way. And, you know, I see how willing they are to help the next generation. And, you know, that one thing that I saw that had a massive impact on me, because I thought, okay, if people are working so hard to help me, you know, for example, reviewing a cover letter or, you know, speaking about their journey or how they got to where they are today, then, you know, there is an obligation for myself to continue that message, to continue to help the next generation come up and, you know, do what they want to do. And so I think you've got to have that, you know, compassion and empathy and a willingness to help others achieve their goals. And I think that's incredibly important for a functional society going forwards and a healthy one too.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's brilliant in terms of, I really only have one question I think left, which is really, you know, you mentioned the summer's coming up, peak time for the business. You're taking some time to focus on growing the company. You know, what's exciting you moving forward? You know, where's the next step of the vision for you in life? And I guess also, how can we support you in that?
Oh, thank you so much. So, you know, I think with the next few steps is really difficult to really pin down, simply because there's so many possibilities in terms of how this business can develop. And I think with me, I've always wanted to see whether this brand can be built, simply because the reason why I chose not to work with a franchise or to join a franchise and open a store in their name is because I wanted that flexibility of being able to implement things that I thought up and, you know, do the next week. And, you know, that is something that is really important for me to have, that flexibility, because I think that contributes to the learning curve. An example of that was, you know, when I had the idea of having these refillable cups that, you know, was a souvenir that they could come and bring in, and I called them a bear cup. It's quite a little cute bear and you get a 10% discount every single time you come in. And that was one idea that I just dreamt up one night. I was like, this would be cool, because you see a lot of big brands doing that. I was like, this is something I want to do. You know, contacted a supplier, and within a month it was here, and now I see all these kids coming in with their little bear cup, and I'm like, this is amazing. So that's one thing that is incredibly exciting, you know, just seeing what direction can I take this in. The next few months, you know, is me trying to grow the business as much as I can and really implement new things. I've got a new line of drinks coming up, a limited edition summer menu, which is incredibly exciting. Been working with the whole team on developing that. And in terms of how, you know, anyone can support going forwards, is I just think that just helping learn, right? Putting people in contact with other people, trying to gain as much momentum in terms of, you know, consuming and understanding the market as you can. And also not just in terms of a business perspective, but a personal one as well. Developing myself as a person, that is the most exciting thing I say, you know, over the next, not just next year or so, but the next decade, right? You're going to continue to learn, continue to grow. And I think that's the most exciting thing about life, right? So, yeah.
Amazing. Definitely. I actually have two more questions.
Go for
me. In between the meal prep business, you winding that down, and the time where you pivoted to, well, it's not a pivot, you started a new business. What was that period like for you? You know, it can be really tough to have a supposed failure, to have an idea that you put your time, your energy, that you had a lot of belief in. What was that period like, and how did you kind of pick yourself back up to start a new venture? Because yeah, I mean, you've had a great ton of success over the last 18 months. It's not easy to run a physical location with staff. But it would have been super easy to just quit and say, maybe business isn't for me. I already have my safe and, you know, going to be very lucrative law job. Maybe I should just focus on that and not go again and try and be an entrepreneur. So, you know, how long was that time period, and what was your emotional or mental state like at that time?
Absolutely. I think, you know, it was quite a tumultuous time. Not just because the business wasn't going the way that I expected, but also because of the coronavirus pandemic. You know, it was a complete change, and, you know, we had no expectations in terms of what we can do. And so for me, actually, when my business didn't go to plan in my first year, you know, it was like a few months. I think we had only started for about 3 months, and then the lockdown happened, the first lockdown. And so for me, at that point, I really had nothing lined up. I didn't even, you know, have a internship or, you know, commercial law career or anything like that at that point. So for me, at that point, I was thinking, okay, let me just sort my life out in terms of university and getting that next step, because I didn't really know what that next step was going to look like. So, you know, during that coronavirus period, I remember Antonio speaking about this on his episode of the podcast, and he was like, he put his head down and really focused on taking advantage of that isolation period. And for me, that's exactly what I did. I, you know, got my grades up, first of all. You know, first year is a bit shaky, you know, had a couple ups and downs simply because I was trying to navigate university itself. Second year, I put my head down and really focused on, you know, getting good grades, ultimately average first throughout all my modules. And then I was thinking, okay, I want to secure my grad offer. I need to get an understanding what the next step was going to look like. And once again, I'd say it was incredibly fortunate for me to, you know, get that quite quickly in terms of, you know, securing a training contract. And, you know, I got that at the end of my second year into my final year. And I think that opened up more opportunities for me to think about the grand perspective. And I think that's a lot of confidence building. You've got to take small wins. You know, small wins. Get, you know, can you wake up at this time that you set yourself? So you rack those up. And then as you take those steps, you feel like, okay, maybe I could take a bigger leap this time. Could I do that? Could I do that? And then you start to realize that your skill set is developing. You're becoming a different person. You're looking at things differently. And then, you know, when the wins come in, the first big one, you're feeling, wow, I've done all of this. Is there any chance that I could take this risk and take it one step further? And, you know, there's this really powerful quote that Charlie Munger made. And he says, never underestimate the man who overestimates himself. And I think that's one thing that I thought, okay, I'm going to do everything that I can and just set these outrageous goals. I'm not going to tell anyone about them. I'm just going to have them in mind and see if it's possible. And, you know, when I started, you know, the business and everything, that was the thing that I was thinking about. Could I make this? Could I make this work? And if it doesn't work, failure for me, and this is one thing that I've written about on my blog, I decided that, you know, one thing to bear in mind is failure is never going to be your identity. It's only an event. Mm-hmm. And I think really recently, Giannis Antetokounmpo says, you know, there's no failure, there's steps to success. And I think, you know, that is immensely powerful. So, you know, that's the way that I slowly overcame all the stutters and all the stumblings that I had. And I think, you know, you're always going to be faced with obstacles. And as you said previously, the obstacle becomes the way. And that's something that Marcus Aurelius in the Meditations really focuses on. Mm-hmm. And I think just being able to ride the wave, keep going, stay persistent, and, you know, one day the winds will come.
Bars. As someone that loves Charlie Munger, I've actually never heard that quote, and that might be the most me Charlie Munger quote ever. Do you want to ask, do you have anything else?
Yeah, I mean, just one last point I wanted to share also that I think Bobby encapsulates very well. It's like, honestly, one of the lessons that served me most well in the last 5 years. It's basically like, if you do good deeds and pass forward knowledge and help people out for the sake of it, really like just to do it, to see people grow, to see people win, help themselves and win, that's one of the best things you can do. Because even if it's not for you, you're going to benefit from seeing you being able to impact this person. Mm. This person's going to remember that you helped their way up. And you're ultimately just going to cause goodwill and good energy to come to you. And so even though it might be the most selfless thing you can do, you can also do it for a selfish perspective. So there's literally no losing in that equation.
Fully. I'm going to wrap up. We're going to do the cheat code ending usually. But I also want to say that, like, to piggyback off of that, I think this podcast, for me anyway, especially just with like the inflection point we are in our business now. And I don't want to just, I don't even want to call it a business, like in our community and our business and our movement. Like this podcast for me, I already said, like, I think this would be the best one that we've done so far. But I think this podcast encapsulates something crazy for me on the point that you said in terms of like sowing seeds for a decade and not realizing where they would go. Like a decade ago is probably where I first heard Bobby's name, and the amount of inspiration and learnings that I've taken from this, like at a time I really need them, is kind of crazy. Because I feel like we've gone from a place where I wouldn't quite go as far as to call myself a mentor, but like a place where I could support and give Bobby guidance, and we can talk as peers now, and I'm learning things from him and inspiration from him. And I think that's incredible, incredibly humbling for me. I feel incredibly blessed, grateful to God to see your transition. But also I think as a company, I think this is like the embodiment of what we've always said we want to build, in the sense of, you know, even if we never make a pound from doing this, just the learnings that we'll take, the relationships that we'll build, the community that we'll build is invaluable. And, you know, it's even crazy to hear like Bobby reference something that you said in a podcast that was helpful, because it shows that like no matter how big or small the audience is, like what we do makes a difference. And it's inspired me to like run up the numbers a lot more aggressively and really keep pumping out the content and being consistent with it. So yeah, I think this was a pivotal one for a number of reasons, but a literally embodiment of what you said in terms of like talking about us building company culture and what one of those values should be. Like win and help win was going to be one of them, in terms of like we want to compete, we want to win, but also finding time to help other people win and to pay it forward is definitely a value that's important to us, and I think what drives Bobby immensely. And so yeah, I just think cheers to ourselves for a dope podcast. Cheers to you if you're still listening, even though I'm sure like you are, because it's incredibly valuable. And yeah, I think the last thing that we've got to do is just to ask you, you know, what your cheat code to the game is. I'm sure you have a ton, but maybe pick one or two.
Sure. So, you know, I've given this a little bit of thought, and I think my biggest cheat code would be adaptability. Knowing when and where to double down on a particular idea and see it through and really be stubborn on that tunnel vision, and when to realize that actually there are better alternatives to take. And I think I take inspiration from this quote from Machiavelli's The Prince. And he says, you know, one must be a fox to discern the snares and a lion to frighten the wolves. And that's really profound, because you've got to be able to know when and where to do any particular thing. And that's both really invaluable in terms of from a personal perspective, but also in terms from a business view. So understanding the market condition, knowing when to really see this through, and knowing when that this, okay, this might not be the one that's going to help. Is this really necessary? And I think, you know, I'm not saying that I've mastered this in any particular way. I think it's tremendously difficult, but I think it's something that is really important to bear in mind and also try to take advantage of. You know, if you're able to read the room, if you're able to read the market to understand where things are going, I think that's something that will be a tremendously important skill going forward. So, yeah.
I think that's a great one to end it on. Absolutely. Thank you so much, Bobby, for, you know, it speaks for itself, so I'm not going to say any more, for an incredible performance. I think we need a Bobby's Bubble Tea podcast as an ongoing series.
We do.
Thanks to you for listening. Thanks, Antonio, for everything. Thanks to Benga, the team here at Soapbox. Another banging episode. And yeah, champs, you know what to do. Like, comment, subscribe. And look, if you like what you've heard here, we'd love to have you join our community of high achieving and giving young people. And yeah, catch you on the next episode.